Hello and welcome to Microsoft Digital Now. I'm Andrew Wilson, Microsoft's Chief Digital Officer. Today, technology is at the heart of every business. Its mission criticality, its speed, is something we're all having to deal with. On this series of conversations, I'm looking forward to speaking with friends, industry leaders, both within Microsoft and across the industry, about how they're tackling digital and wider business transformation. So let's get to it. Low code, zero code, no code, democratized code. We enterprise technologists are dealing with more malleable capabilities and platforms, systems than ever before. And I'm delighted to say, joining me now is my good friend Charles from Microsoft. Charles, you lead biz apps and platforms. We enterprise technologists, we're now presented with everybody being a developer. Help us unpack that a little bit. Tell us about your role and the capabilities that you lead and what that can bring to organizations and people like me who are trying to run that tech for the organization.
Absolutely. So first off, thanks for having me. Great to have a conversation about low code, which is a huge passion of mine. I head up the product management, so engineering, program management, design, all of that for low code platforms at Microsoft, which includes things like Power Apps and Power Automate and Power Virtual Agent. And with so many of our customers kind of working through what does low code mean to them, it's all about figuring out how do you both enable the entire organization to participate in development in a way which never really has been possible before, while at the same time governing, enabling, and securing all these great solutions that are being built. And this is a kind of a whole new type of challenge that every company is working through, because instead of 1,000 apps or 1,500 apps, maybe you have 10,000 apps or 100,000 apps. And instead of having a strong security review for every single push to production, you now have business users deploying each and every day. So that balance and working through this ability to empower everybody, but at the same time protect the company, is super interesting, super challenging, but it's defining low code for all the customers we work with.
I mean, it's really making technology pervasive. You know, everybody is a potential developer, yet the enterprise technology persona is still there, but perhaps the role has changed. I've certainly felt that, because people are looking to us saying, well, we'll do that, you'll do that. Here are the guide rails. Talk to us a little bit about the evolution of Power Platform and how enterprise technologists should look at it rather than just replacing what they did before. And then the change management side as well. What sort of use cases developed? How did you see customers adopting it?
Yeah, so I think one of the really big things which is new today with low code is that it's all cloud native, cloud hosted. So what that means is even if you go out and make it so everybody can build solutions, you can actually see what they're doing centrally. So this ability for IT to actually control and empower and manage from afar while still having everybody at the edge of the company use these solutions to build amazing apps and automations and chatbots and websites and dashboards is something which is unique to this generation of low code. Additionally, what we see a lot of customers doing is they're embracing this idea of what's called a fusion team. And that's where you bring together business users who use these no code, low code tools like the Power Platform, together with professional developers who use code to build microservices, AI models, data models to empower the low-code development environment. And customers like Schlumberger have an amazing practice where inside the IT organization, you have the same type of developers you always did, but they're not just always building solutions themselves, they're also building the components and the building blocks which the business users pick up and leverage themselves inside of tools like the Power Platform. So kind of a lot of interesting changes in dynamics, which make this generation of low code different from what we've seen in the past.
So it's additive and complementary. So those low coders, do they need a lot of training, or are you seeing them picking it up and running with it pretty much by themselves?
I'd say the vast majority of low code developers just pick up the tool and go. And if we look at kind of our own telemetry, we can see the majority of users just discover Power Platform, whether it's from a web search or an in-product integration, and they just start building. Of course, training and enablement makes it more effective and more productive, but it's not necessarily required as long as you create the right management environment for kind of that creative low-code development to take root. And if we look at probably the most successful customers, like one of my favorite is GlaxoSmithKline, they've really embraced this idea of creating a culture and a community of self-service, self-identifying, self-starting citizen developers using tools like the Power Platform.
As a technologist and a leader of technology within an organization like Microsoft, I look at the democratization of code running in parallel with the democratization of data, and now we're democratizing work and the changing practices. How much do they land together? And from your perspective, can you call out any other adoption scenarios that you think are encouraging for those perhaps organizations that haven't started or are early on in this journey?
I mean, the first thing is you're exactly right that there's this bigger trend, which I think has been true in computing for the last 30, 40 years, which is things which used to be reserved for experts, a small set of people, become accessible to more and more people every year. And you think about going from mainframes to personal computers to mobile devices, from databases to spreadsheets. It's kind of this constant trend of amazing digital capabilities being enabled for more and more users every year. And we've gotten to the point where data, reporting, analytics, app development, automation have been democratized and accessible to everybody. So, and that's kind of the big inflection point that we see. And there's some great studies out there from Gartner where they say 65% or more of enterprise app dev just in 2 years will be done with low-code tools. So it's a very rapid shift happening in real time. And for companies that have not yet responded to this shift, the first thing I'd say is it's never too late. And the best time probably to get started was maybe a couple of years ago, but the second best time is tomorrow or today. And there's all these amazing resources and amazing capabilities and amazing communities to help you on that journey. And the thing is, it's just like what you mentioned earlier, it's additive, it doesn't replace. So we don't have to worry about, does that mean developers go away or IT goes away? No, it's just a new set of tools, some new faces, some new people participating and contributing to digital transformation.
The question I would always ask you, I have to do it here. Can code democratization and security occur together? And from your perspective, how should those that are worried about the security aspect of things regard low coders with 65% happening in the hands?
Yeah, I'd say the first thing is, yes, absolutely, they can coexist. And the best way to kind of manage this is to be proactive. Every customer we work with, they always go, I wish I had a proactive security and governance strategy for low code before I began. And because if you create those rules around data loss protection, deployments, so code editing, that type of thing, from the beginning, you make sure that that low-code environment inside your organization forms within those boundaries and within those constraints. And you get the same innovation without a giant mess on the other side. If you don't do that, what happens is people are going to find a way to solve their problems. They're going to pick up whatever low-code, no-code tool they can and start building.
And do it anyway.
Exactly. So the time is now. It's kind of, it reminds me back in 2012, 2013, when stuff started to move to the public cloud. There's a lot of questions of, can you really go to the public cloud? Can every workload go? 10 years later, it's pretty clear that things are going to the public cloud. And the majority of customers have gone and started that journey. Low-code is in that same place. 10 years from now, we'll look back and go, how did we ever think that development wouldn't have a low-code component inside of every enterprise? So I'd say get started, be proactive, define the security controls that you need from day one, not on day 1,000. That's the most important way to be successful.
And I do think it's exciting. I know I joke with you, but it creates a whole new persona for us technologists to make everyone successful with this richer set of technology capabilities. Now, on the subject of richer software capabilities, it would be wrong to invite you on the show without pressing you for some secrets. So talk to us about what's coming next. What should we expect and look forward and be excited about?
So I say one of the most interesting things that we're seeing for low code is this idea of AI-assisted development. And for folks that kind of go look at pro devs, you may have seen things like GitHub Copilot, where an AI model trained in all the open source code out there can actually help you be so much more productive. And we have stats like 30% of code is now written with GitHub Copilot, that type of thing. Now, we've taken that same idea and we started to reimagine it in the context of low-code, no-code. So for example, inside Power Apps, you can now use natural language to describe data queries and data filters, and we'll automatically do the binding even to a SQL database or an SAP instance. Similarly, you can even draw on a whiteboard, take a picture and upload it, and we'll generate an app for you. And we'll also generate the data model behind that app for you. Same thing's true for PDF forms and a whole bunch of other things. Or in the case of Power Automate and Power Apps, you can even provide examples of data transformation. Like, this is my input data, this is what I want my output data to look like, and we'll generate the program for you. So all these amazing AI capabilities, which further lower the barrier to build beautiful apps, capable apps, and understand and leverage your data is being made possible by all these amazing AI breakthroughs. And this is something that we're seeing as a key ingredient to take low-code, no-code to the next level. Because instead of even having to know an Excel look expression, what if you could just talk to a computer and it would help you build the app you need? That's the dream.
It's putting the whole power of the stack behind something which was that much more accessible and consumable.
Absolutely.
I look forward to seeing that. Now, before we go, we always like to find out a little bit more about our friends on the sofa. So I can't imagine when you were six that you wanted to be a biz apps and platform leader. So what did you want to be growing up?
I wanted to work at NASA. So I actually, and I'd say, unlike a lot of people who are in software, we're like, you know, at 5 years old, I was writing computer programs. I didn't write a computer until I was like 12 years old. And I tried aerospace. I tried, just airplanes. I worked at Lockheed Martin. You know, I tried a bunch of different things before I kind of stumbled into programming. But I always wanted to go work in the space program. That was kind of a dream.
Very topical. Very topical. And during lockdown, which we're all in, how did you spend your time? Any new hobbies, interests, or focus that emerged for you?
Yeah, I would say two things, which occupied a lot of my time during the pandemic. The first was we actually got five dogs at home. So believe it or not, that is a surprising amount of attention required. Lots of walking, lots of prepping, lots of haircuts, that type of thing. So that was an interesting experience for sure. And a lot of those are rescues. So people are out there. Rescue dogs is a great thing to do. Second thing is also, in our team, we had a weekly virtual happy hour every Friday evening when we were all locked in our homes. And as part of that, I started to research and became, I think, a decent mixologist in terms of making cocktails and drinks. So my team would always make fun of the things I would create, but I was very proud of them. So that's kind of what I learned.
Charles, thank you for spending your time with us. Before you go, from everybody on the show, we wanted to say a great thank you to you and leave you with a little gift from us. We'll have it here. So one of the things I did in lockdown was to build things with Lego. So knowing about your passion and interest in pets, I got you some cats and dogs. There's not as many as you've got dogs here, but this is a little thank you from us.
Thank you.
So we look forward to seeing them those. And perhaps a little bit more seriously, I know you're passionate about rescue. Absolutely salute that. So we have here a little gift certificate, and we're going to make a contribution in your name to the Seattle Humane Society because it's a great cause. Look after dogs, as I know you do.
Awesome.
Charles, thanks very much for being on the show
today. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Look forward to seeing you again soon.